One thing I wanted to announce, some of you may know I am a deputy editor for JAMA, and JAMA has not been known for publishing a lot of rigorous studies in women's health, and that is changing. And so we are looking for rigorous studies to be in JAMA. Some of you have helped. Sandy, thank you. There's others who have helped. Cynthia has helped. So thank you very much for helping us get the high quality studies and opinion pieces into JAMA. And I will be the editor-in-chief of the new JAMA Super Channel site, where we collate all of women's health stuff across JAMA. And so together we can build that with the high quality science we're planning to do. You can reach me at UCSD or through my JAMA email. And I think we all recognize that part of that initiative, part of what's happening here today with the great leadership that's in CORI, is that women's health research has just been in the back row too long, way too long. And though it wasn't all that long ago that women were excluded from clinical research because of, you know, that H word, those hormones, but hey, you know, it's 2025 and we're smart people and we can deal with fluctuating hormones, so people shouldn't be afraid of that anymore, really. And so research has in women's health has been sort of thought about as reproductive, pregnancy, menopause, breast cancer, and that's a very small scope when in fact we know that multiple speakers today have commented on the broadened scope of women's health. We know that specific biological, social, lifestyle factors profoundly impact women's health across the lifespan, and yet we have major features that are unexplained, like why women live longer than men. I'm happy that's the case, but nobody has an erudite explanation for why that is. So we're going to talk about some basic things like menopause, clearly a natural biological event, but it's far more than just the cessation of menstruation. It can influence every system in a woman's body. And we know that from a lot of different areas of medicine. We know, for example, that women have their own unique cardiovascular symptoms, which were discounted for many years, as many women's voices are over a variety of topics. We know that certain adverse events that occur during pregnancy increase cardiovascular risk not only during pregnancy, but after pregnancy, and even decades later in life. And so many areas of clinical medicine have benefited when we take a broadened look at women's health, bone health, metabolic health, neurologic and cognitive health, mental health. And guess what? Menopause and aging actually don't care what your subspecialty is or what your area of research focuses. They happen in all these areas. So all clinicians should have an up-to-date understanding of these natural biological events. And with all the change that we have going on in our world right now, and there's quite a bit, some of which has probably happened in the last hour that I don't even know about yet, but with all that change, these changes of menopause and aging are very predictable. So let's make sure we have a good understanding of them. So in this next section, you're going to learn about some really fantastic studies from three superb researchers. We're going to talk about glycobiology and the intricate and often transformative processes of menopause and aging. Dr. Amanda Lewis is a professor in obstetrics, gynecology, and reproductive sciences, and the director of the UC Glycosciences Consortium for Women's Health, among many other significant roles. And I know her to be a thoughtful, careful investigator, and I really appreciate how she mentors and connects others. And we know we talk about women glowing in pregnancy, but she's going to give you a new idea about what glowing can look like. And then after Mandy, Dr. Mariana Alpern, professor and vice chair for translational research, will share her thoughts on genitourinary syndrome of menopause, nicknamed GSM. And through her laboratory studies and her clinical urogynecology care, she's contributed new insights to our evolving understanding of GSM as well as many other areas of pelvic health. And Dr. Andrea LaCroix, distinguished professor, epidemiologist, and well-established women health researchers, will close out the session with a wonderful presentation on healthy aging after menopause, and I know there'll be a lot of personal and professional interest in that. So just before I step away, concerted efforts to improve disease prevention and personalized care for individuals and populations are greatly needed. All women should benefit from rigorous science that informs high quality clinical care, healthy menopause transitions, and as much vitality as they age as possible. And at this time when there's so much despair amongst researchers, I encourage you to link arms, hold your heads high, and really support high-impact research through your intellectual efforts and your daily behaviors. So thank you for being here to support this conference, the presentations that are being shown today, and continue this important journey to improve women's health. Thank you all.